الرحيم الحمد لله الذي شرفنا على سائر الأمم برسالات من اختصه من بين الأنام بجوامع الكلم وجواهر الحكم صلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم ما نطق اللسان بمدحه ونسخ القلم أما بعد. My dear respected elders, teachers, honorable guests and sisters listening at home, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi.
21st century, the so-called civilized era, the Muslims of today have now become infatuated with desires to such an extent that their minds are contaminated with diseases for which there is no diagnosis, instilled with viruses for which there's no antivirus, antiquated with nafs and worldly affairs in which it causes a great crisis. You know, if we take an insight into a person's life, we will realize that everything revolves around the dunya, to where this person indulges himself into sins, to where this sinning becomes a habit, to where this habit becomes a norm. Now, if we take a look into the Sahaba's lives, we will find that everything coincided with the akhirah, where they inclined themselves towards ibadah, where this obedience opened the doors of success for them, to where this ultimately entitled them with the title radiyallahu ta'ala anhum wa radu an, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. You know, this brings us as Muslims into context, as we supposedly the sparkling diamonds, the precious gems of this world, have now been engraved and conceived with the dirt and fitna that this world hosts today. Explaining this, there is a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, hadith number 4015, where it states, عن عمر بن عوف رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فوالله ما الفقر أخشى عليكم. The Amr bin Auf narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I swear upon Allah, it is not poverty which I fear for you. Now the question arises is that why did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that it is poverty which he does not fear for us? And the answer is that the people who are suffering from poverty, the people who are poverty stricken, the fuqara, the masakin, the already devoted to the deen, you know, various hadith are mentioned regarding them, such as the hadith in both Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is recorded to have said, قُمْتُ عَلَى بَابِ الْجَنَّةِ فَإِذَا عَامَّةُ مَنْ دَخَلَهَا الْمَسَاكِينَ, that I was standing at the doors of Jannah and the majority of those entering were the masakin. Now going back to the previous hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continues to say, وَلَكِنْ أَخْشَى أَنْ تُبْسَطَ عَلَيْكُمُ الدُّنْيَا كَمَا بُسِطَتْ عَلَى مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ فَتَنَافَسُوهَا كَمَا تَنَافَسُوهَا وَتُهْلِكَكُمْ كَمَا أَهْلَكَتْهُمْ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, but I feel that worldly things may be given to you lavishly as were given to your predecessors, and you may compete with one another in acquiring them just as your predecessors did, and then the world may destroy you as it destroyed them. Now if we look at ourselves, whatever we want, we get. Whatever we require, we already have. And you know, we've become such people that we buy what we don't need with the money that we don't have for the people that we don't like. And then in each and every single aspect, we're always competing, whether it be regarding status, whether it be regarding wealth, whether it be regarding property. But that's the difference between us and the Sahaba, because when they would compete in regards to taqwa and piety. You know, each and every action of theirs was with devotion and sincerity. You know, they weren't afraid of their image in front of people. You know, automatically us like today, we have this mindset, we have this mentality that we need to have an image, we need to show something when we approach people. But the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, their mindset, their mentality was on the Quran ayat, يَوْمَ إِذٍ تُعْرَضُونَ لَا تَخْفَى مِنْكُمْ خَافِيَةٌ. That on that day when you will be presented before your Lord, no deed will be hidden. They're worried about their state, they're worried about their condition, they're worried about what their image would be when they approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day. You know, each and every single Sahabi, when it comes to sacrifice, they were at the pinnacle level. You know, we already know about the difficulties and sacrifices that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum had gone through. You know, days would pass, weeks would pass, and they would just suffice with one, two morsels of food. And it used to go to such an extent that they would have to tie stones to their stomachs to ease their hunger. But the true reality is, my brothers, is that our stomachs are full and our hearts are empty. And the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, you know, their stomachs may have been empty, but their hearts were full of iman. You know, each and every single Sahabi was a physical manifestation of the term Zahid al-Dunya. You know, they were the masters of abstinence. A Sahabi named Salman al-Farsi radiallahu anhu, he quotes in relation to abstinence, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ إِذَا زَهَدَ فِي الدُّنْيَا, that verily when a servant exercises abstinence in the matter of the world, إِسْتَنَارَ قَلْبُهُ بِالْحِكْمَةِ, then his heart becomes illuminated with wisdom, وَتَعَاوَنَتْ أَعْضَاهُ بِالْعِبَادَةِ, and his limbs become his helpers in the matter of worship. And this was the state and condition of each and every single Sahabi. You know, each and every single Sahabi had a transitive nature. You know, for one little sin, for one action inconsistent with the teachings of Islam, they would go to the extreme limit in correcting themselves. You know, let's take an example of a Sahabi called Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu. You know, at the Battle of the Trench, Ghazwatul Khandaq, the Muslims, they had a pact with Banu Qurayza. And Banu Qurayza were a small Jewish community. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had told Banu Qurayza to stay at the back with their women and children. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam instructed that a trench be built at the front so that when the mushrikeen, the enemy, come, they encounter this trench. But Banu Qurayza, they had broke this pact. And in realization of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam knowing about this, they hid themselves. And there was a siege for 25 days. You know, for 25 days, no food was coming in, no food was going out. And after 25 days had passed and their food supplies had finished, they wanted peace negotiations. And they requested that Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu be sent to them, for he was a previous ally of theirs. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he accepted their request. And he said, Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu. Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, he entered the fort. And at an instant, the women began crying, "Oh Abu Lubaba, oh Abu Lubaba, look at us, look at the children. What shall we do? Shall we surrender?" And the only response Abu Lubaba made was a hand gesture like this. In essence, he was telling them they were about to die. Thereafter, he exited the fort. And he realized his mistake, that he was sent for peace negotiations, but he went against the regulations. And thereafter, he headed to Masjid Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he tied himself to a pillar. And he made the intention that I will not leave this pillar until a Quranic ayat is revealed in my favor, until I am shown a sign of forgiveness. Until today, that same pillar is known as Ustuwanatul Tawbah, the pillar of repentance. The news reached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Why had he not just come to me, and I would have done istighfar on his behalf?" Nevertheless, Abu Lubab radiallahu anhu, he stayed tied to the pillar till shortly after the Quran ayat was revealed. وَآخَرُونَ اعْتَرَفُوا بِذُنُوبِهِمْ خَلَطُوا عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَآخَرَ سَيِّئًا عَسَى اللَّهُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. That there are those that had admitted their sins and they had mixed righteous deeds with those that are bad, but Allah subhanahu wa taala has forgiven them. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most beneficent, the most merciful. A Sahabi near the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard this, she got overjoyed and she rushed to Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, and she said to Abu Lubaba, "Oh Abu Lubaba, a Quranic ayat has been revealed in your favor, you can untie yourself, you have been forgiven." But Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, he refused. He insisted that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself comes and unties him. You know, this was Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, this was one sin, this was his regret. You know, truly there is no comparison between us and the strength of iman that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum had. You know, the books of history were given a new chapter with the sacrifices that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum gave for the deen. However, history is of no benefit if lessons are not drawn from it. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum left this world with a legacy which even the non-believers are compelled to admire. You know, today we name ourselves as Bilal, we name ourselves as Saad, we name ourselves as Mu'ad, etc. But do we ever think about those that had brought life to these names? You know, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they were people just like you and I. They ate, they drank, they married, they slept. But it was due to their unparalleled self-sacrifice that they had excelled and reached the level of radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa radu an. This is the very lesson we need to learn from their illuminous lives if we want to also leave a legacy which inspires those coming after us to aspire. As the poet says, as the poet encapsulates beautifully, أولئك قوم شيد الله فخرهم فما فوقه فخر وإن عظم الفخر. That these were such people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had consolidated their honor, and there can be no honor greater than their honor, regardless of how great that honor may be. We make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He revives and instills within us the dignity, the glory, the character, and the honor that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum had inside us. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.